Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though he die. Whoever lives by believing in me will never die. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Welcome, everybody, to this Thanksgiving service of Arthur. Arthur to many, William Arthur Bennison. We welcome friends. We welcome, of course, the family, this wonderful family. And we, as we gather here today, thank you for coming. And we're here to remember this wonderful, wonderful man of God. So, as we pray, loving God, your love is stronger than death. By you, we are all being brought to life. Help us, as we hear the promises of your word, to believe them and to receive the comfort they offer. You are the giver of hope. Fill us with joy and peace in believing, that our fears may be dispelled, our loneliness eased, our hope reawakened, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Just want to introduce to you Rodney. He is a family friend, of course, for many, many years. We've known him a long, long time. And so I'll just welcome Rodney to the... here.
Thank you. Yes, to whatever.
Good morning, everybody. Good to see you. And great to be together with dear friends, Jonathan and Jim, Joanna. Funerals are us, so if you're looking to... There you go. But it is a real privilege to be here with you today and to remember this really remarkable man. And often one of the big discussions when planning a funeral is how long it will last. And people, you know, if you go to a crematorium, sometimes you have to be in and out in about 15, 20 minutes. And when you think about it, we're here to give thanks for a person who was 81, am I right? 81 years, a man who's left an impression, I think, on all of our lives. So please don't worry too much about the time in that sense, unless you're a speaker, in which case I do want you to worry about the time. But everyone else, just let's sit back and thank God. The Bible says, give honour to whom honour is due. Arthur was an unassuming man, wasn't he? And yet he'd be there at the door welcoming people for decades. And so he's known around the world. And I know people will be watching this from the recorded version in days to come. So if you're watching in some future date, we hope that you appreciate the service and with us give thanks to God for our dear beloved Arthur. I know that our thoughts and prayers are with his family here at the front today, daughter Amy and husband Jimmy. Also for the grandchildren, Alice, Holly, Maisie, Harriet and Millie. For Arthur's son and his wife, David and Catherine. With grandchildren, Harry, Hannah, Isabel. And I understand Arthur's only surviving sister, Hilda, is she here? She couldn't make it today, bless her. Well, maybe she'll be one who'll be watching this. So Hilda, if you're watching, we honour you and thank God for you today. Arthur was a unique Yorkshireman who we'll hear much about in the coming moments, from his humble beginnings in the heart of Billsdale in God's own county, through to his love of farming, to his life here at Hollybush, his travels and his exploits, and of course, most importantly, his family, whom he loved so dearly. As I was thinking about Arthur, I thought, in a way, he became almost the very personification of Hollybush, because he was always full of the joy of the Lord, and the only word that ever would come from his lips whenever he gave you a hug was, glory, that's right. I mean, what a reputation to have. And I know that Arthur would want us to give glory to his Saviour and our Lord here today. It was my privilege to visit Arthur during his stays in hospital. And as some of you may recall me mentioning at Jane and Arthur's, at Jane's funeral, I had the privilege of marrying them well over 50 years ago. That was my first marriage following ordination. But it must have been a good marriage because we have a wonderful family here that's come as a result. So we thank God for that. On one of those visits, in actual fact, if I can go back a little bit, during Arthur's stay in hospital, there was a period when both he and Jane were in hospital. And he sang with Amy the hymn that we're going to sing just now. He was in the high dependency unit. And Amy has this on video of Arthur singing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. And just a few days before he passed, I visited him at Amy's home there. And again, we sang together. And if you could have seen Arthur, he had hardly any voice, but he was mouthing every word, wasn't he, Amy? And when we came to that line, this is my story, praising my Saviour, and his mouth opened wide and he held that on like a good one. So I want you to do the same in honour of Arthur. Would you stand with me as we sing together? Blessed Assurance. And let's really lift the roof in honour of his Lord and Saviour today. Thank you, gentlemen.
Blessed.
Please take your seats. Mervyn, come and share the scriptures with us. And then I'm going to ask John and Ernest to come and bring their tributes. Please follow on after Mervyn. Thank you.
Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And just one other reading in Revelation 21, verse 1 to 7. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. And there shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Real privilege to read these scriptures this morning at Arthur's funeral, and want to say one quick little word. Arthur travelled with us three times on mission trips, once to Thailand, twice to Nepal. And the time that he went to Thailand with us was absolutely remarkable. And Arthur's wife, Jane, rang Lucy one day and she said, If ever you need any work doing at any of the children's homes, Arthur would be happy to do it. And then Lucy was in Thailand a few months later, and she rang me up and she said, you know, she was staying with Patty, the lady that was looking after these children, and she said, you know what Patty needs is somebody like a farmer, a retired farmer, that can come and do some jobs for him. And I said, well, what about Arthur? Oh, she said, oh, I forgot what I said. Well, Jane said. So the next time we went, Arthur went with us. And wow, what an experience. We was driving up to northern Thailand and we drove past this golden Buddha. It must have been three stories high. And we looked out, and Arthur looked out at him and he says, "By lad, look at that youth. What's he doing up there?" Absolutely incredible. And but you know, he got to Patty's house and the children's home there, and he put a brand new kitchen in for Patty. We dropped him off there and we went off to Burma. We picked him up 2 weeks later and he fitted a new kitchen for Patty. And while he was doing it, one of the children was taken ill. And so Patty had to go down to the hospital with this child. And she left Arthur in charge of the children's home. And absolutely amazing, you know. And Arthur was busy working every day. And the children said, well, we'll cook for you, Arthur. And I was talking to Arthur, I said, bye, lad. He said, that food was hot. the kids really like hot curry. And so they were piling the curry in, and poor old Arthur was sweating. And Arthur said to me, do you know, he said, them kids were mixing concrete with the bare feet. But he had a wonderful time while he was there. When we got home from that trip to Thailand, I said to Arthur, don't drive home tonight because we'd already flown all the way back from Thailand. I said, stop overnight, drive back next morning. Next morning we got up to have breakfast and Lucy said, just pray, Arthur, just pray a blessing on the food. And he started to pray and he burst into tears. And we said, what is it, Arthur? He said, you know, he said, when I was a young man, God told me many, many years ago that one day I would visit Thailand on a mission trip. And he said, God has just done it. And he was just absolutely overwhelmed. And I'll just finish with this. I was talking to Patty 12 months later when we was there, and she said, of all the people that ever came to help me in Thailand, Arthur was the best by a mile. Yes. He's wonderful, wasn't he? He was wonderful. So God bless you all. Praise the Lord.
Well, to me, Arthur was unique, was truly unique, and I'm sure everybody here will agree with that. Arthur was also like a brother to me. I never had a brother, but he was there, and he was always willing, no matter what you wanted to do. I've known Arthur since early 40s, mid-40s, when we went to the Sunday school together. Arthur always was a good boy. He sat on the front row. I sat in the back. Yeah, you all know what, why. Them days, we farmed opposite Arthur in the valley, and if you read the book, you'll hear all the other stuff as well. And we were on the same estate as Arthur, but Arthur's dad was my Sunday school teacher, and I think he put a lot into us. But one thing you might know, might not know, was Arthur never said a piece at the chapel anniversary or sing a solo. He got up once to do it, and his sort of nerves took over and he never did it. But after Arthur got saved and filled with the Spirit, he went all over the world, as we've already heard. Isn't that a testimony to the wonderful Saviour that we've got? That he can bring somebody that's tongue-tied to speak out for the Lord. Lorne Wilkinson took us to Earl's Court with Paul here, and there was five of us used to go about together. And heard Billy Graham there, and he said, when you go back home, start a Bible study. Well, we started a Bible study, but for us, it was me and Arthur, it was about a 30-mile round trip to go there, but we used to rejoice going down there. We soon learnt that not everybody believed like what we did. But that really pushed you into reading your Bible and sorting out answers. And God was gracious to us and helped us. I can remember bringing Arthur first time to Holly Bush. We climbed up the uncarpeted back stairs to the hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness. And indeed it was. When we left Billsdale, Arthur came to work at Holly Bush, travelling with Jim to meetings all over. On one trip to Romania, he called to see me as I was working in Belgium at that time. Arthur was on his way to Romania to deliver Bibles and things like that, and I think he had a tremendous time out there. Later, Arthur came to visit me in Uganda, and the bishop put on an evangelistic tour for us into the villages, an experience Arthur never forgot. To Arthur, black or white made no difference, and God greatly used him and the team. Over the last 2 years, it's been a privilege to visit Jane and Arthur on a Thursday. Not every day, but every week, but it's been tremendous. We've always had a time of prayer. He knew where he was going. I'm sure the welcome he got when he got there would be, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into thy eternal rest."
How can you follow that? Arthur to me was like a brother, as John has just said. He was like part of a family, both Arthur and Jane and the family. He was a great friend, besides being my workmate. And the things we did together. There was never a wrong word from Arthur. He took it all in his stride. And when we were doing things, he used to always say, "It'll be all right. It'll do." In the earlier days, when I was driving and coming in with a wagon, I found out sometimes I had a broken spring on the wagon, and what I would do, as long as I got into the yard, I'd come in and I'd go down to Arthur. "What are you doing tonight?" "Nout." "Why, what's wrong?" "Well," so I went, "you had to give me a hand to lift the spring back into place." "That's the broken another, Jan." He was there whenever you needed him. Nothing was too hard. Because when, you know, you had to lift the spring in, it was about 200 weight. Well, I couldn't do it on my own. And we used to do it together. When we got into the place, he'd say, "That's it, that's done. You'll be right." Another time, we were down the field there, in the next field, up to near, below the ploughing field, and I was working on the fence, and he shouts at me. I says, "Now what's done?" He says, "I've gone and bogged out a forklift." I says, "You what?" "It's down that belly." He says, "I'll have to go and get a big tractor and some blocks and a jack." Well, you know, more up. Jacked it up, the further I went into the ground, because it was so soft. Anyhow, we got it done. He says, "There it is, we're right. I won't have to deal with that again." There was times when we went out with a minivan from here, groups of us, up the dale. I see some of you were shaking their heads of where we used to go, different places. And we were travelling along one time, I think we were coming back from Ingleton, and there was a dead cat on the road. "It's a transport muggy." Never heard of that before. Anyhow, Jane looked it up in the dictionary and he said, "It's a real word. It's transformer." When I get my tongue around, "transform muggy." often when we going out, there were times I'll be asked out to go to preach, and I would say to her, just don't want to ride out. Aye, I'll come with you. Yes. He was a great pal, a great friend, and part of the family. When we used to cook, Jane was bad, I used to go down there every week to see how they were getting on. That's after I finished working. You know, when you think back, I've been retired 20, 30 years or more. It's a long time when you're working together, over 50 odd years. He was, as John said, he was like a brother. Yes, we stuck together. And when we went anywhere, or if he was going anywhere, he'd come, "Ern, is the doing out tonight?" And we'd go together. I was there, working in the barn with him, the day that sheep hit him right in the eye. I was catching the lambs, and he was injecting them. And I really don't know what really happened, but I passed the lamb over to him, and next minute it gave one charge and hit him right in the face, and it had horns. And that's why he nearly lost his eye. I said, "You better get yourself to hospital." He says, nay, it'll be right. Anyhow, I sent him down to the house, and Jane was at home as it happened that day, and she says, "Right, the hospital." And, yeah, it was a shock when that happened, you know, when something happens and you're there, you're part of the situation. We never ever fell out. He was always there. And I would find that he'd be same with Jim. When there was anything to do, Arthur would be there. And also included with Arthur, Edwin was part of the trio as we worked together. We just were a team that all knew Jesus. And this was what the difference was, working with Arthur. We never had any wrong words or swear words. And what a pleasure it was to be able to work alongside Arthur. Yes, it was happy days.
Well, somebody said to me today, "Now, young man."
I keep telling people I'm all right at top half. Anyway, Jim rang me and said, "Would I say this recitation?" And Rodney rang the other night and said, "There's ever so many saying a lot." And my wife said, "Don't you say much." So I'm under petticoat government. But I am going to say a few words before I say the recitation. Now, it's wonderful, isn't it? I want you just to stop and think about all the wonderful people that God's brought into your life. nothing happens by chance. And Arthur was one of the many. My few words are this. My memory goes back 64 years when I first met Arthur's dad. He came and he took the Harvest Festival at our chapel, and somebody commented, he said, oh, he's a grand fella, he's Len Bennison. But he says, it's a pity about his lad Arthur. He spends too much time in pub. We'll move on 8 years. Arthur got dramatically converted. And it was a dramatic conversion. I remember in 68, we went to the Farley Convention. And we met up, Harry and Elsie Farrington, Peter and Ida Whiteside, and that was a long association. Arthur was always full of the joy of the Lord, wasn't he? I just wanted to tell you three things. You know, I used to conduct a love feast up in Coverdale. Well, at these love feasts, you reckon to let the old men get up and give their testimony. But Arthur was first on his feet. Hallelujah. I remember going to Esketh Bank with Arthur to hear Tom Butler. And we came back to the Farringtons for supper. And Tom Butler says, well, our friends have a long way to go back. We'll have a word of prayer. And then they can be on their way. Arthur says, oh, I'm all right. Night's young yet. We landed back at 2 o'clock in the morning. I says, you'll come in, Arthur. And he came in. And he sat on till 5 o'clock. Oh, we talked after. He says, oh, birds were singing nicely up Billsdale when I went up. He hadn't a lot of sense of time, had he? And John says, I have a text for you, Arthur. Don't stay in your neighbour's house till he grows weary of it. Another time we went to Cockfield to take a meeting. And Arthur bounced out of the car and said to the pastor, how long do you want? We can give you till midnight. The pastor says, well, you might be here, but I won't. There's only one time I've known Arthur under the weather, and that was when we visited Uganda. Arthur and his friend Brad said they had this text, eat what was set before you. Well, I says, you lads can please yourselves. But I said, I kept telling him, I said, I'm not a very big eater and I'm on a diet. Well, Arthur went down with his violent bug. And I can see him yet. In Uganda, he says, oh, I wish I'd never come here. There was poor Arthur, as we say in Yorkshire, spewing his guts out. Arthur has always been a dalesman. You can take a man out of the dales, but you can't take the Dales out of a man. And so Jim asked me to say this recitation. If you'll need an interpreter, because it's all in Yorkshire dialect, but it's about a Yorkshire shepherd to his dog. See, there's a puzzle the way up again, old dog. There's puzzle the way in again. Thou knows very well that I've gotten me tea, and say thou comes nuzzling up to fireside to me, with same faithful look in the bonny brown eye. Aight, same look in the bonny brown eye. Thou knows every word that I say, odd dog. Thou was never yan to tell twice. A wave, or a shout, or a whistle to thou, thou was off like quickstones, wet wark what to do. Fleet of foot, keen of brain, always loyal and true. Aye, always loyal and true. Went snowstorm, come down thick and fast during night, and sheep were all buried on moor. It was thou, thou knew where every yan on them lay, as we toiled up to Toxters it first lay today. Thou brought every yan on them safely away, every one on them safely away. Went killer, were up on moor, odd dog, running wild upon moor among sheep. We fought for me lambs for dusk till dawn, and come back at daylight all bleeding and torn, but never a yow left for lamb, odd dog, but never a yow left for lamb. Parson says that there wasn't a sow, Lord God, odd dog. He says thou isn't a sow. He's a far land man and a deal wiser than me, with his Greek and his Hebrew and his theology. But he knows nought about dogs, psych as thee. He knows nought about dogs, psych as thee. I read for me sen, taught book of a night. I read it, taught book every night. And a greater than him that loved both man and beast, bidding them on his right hand his heavenly feast, said, well done for being faithful in things that was least. Those being faithful in things that was least. We're Beath on us, Wankle, and Wembley, and Odd. Our flitting time, bounty comes soon. Thou's fought a good fight, lad. Thou's run a straight race. Good shepherd would never shoot deer in thy face. Nay, above green pastures he'll find thou a place. And I hope he'll find yan for me, odd dog. I hope he'll find yan for me.
I was walking around in lambing shed two or three nights since. We lamb a lot of hogs, year-old lambs to them that don't know. And when you first bring them in, they're a bit skitty. But the time they've been in a bit, and you walk around them over day and over night, just to check what's happening, if anything, and they settle down. And you can just walk among them, and you can step over them, and they're just there. They're at peace. And the word drops into my mind, acquaint yourself with him, and be at peace. And that was Arthur. He was acquainted with the shepherd. He knew his shepherd. He was at peace. All the time. All the time. I'm only echoing what others have said. And so I've privileged just to sing one of Arthur's many favourite songs, Down From His Glory, about our shepherd.
Down from his glory, ever living story, my God and Savior came, and Jesus was his name. Born in a manger, his own a stranger, a man of sorrows, tears, and agony. Oh, how I love him, how my sunshine, my all in all, the great Creator became my Savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in him.
Can we just lift it up one, Brian?
What condescension, bringing us redemption, that in the dead of night not one faint hope in sight. God gracious, tender, laid aside his splendor, stooping to woe, to win, to save my soul. Oh, how I love him, how I adore him, my breath, my sunshine, my all in all, the great Creator. My Savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in him. Without reluctance, flesh and blood, his substance, he took the form of man, revealed the hidden plan. Oh, glorious mystery! sacrifice of Calvary. And now I know thou art the great I am. Oh, how I love him, how I adore him, my breath, my sunshine,
of the proceedings where you begin to wonder what else can be said, but fortunately I've got 3 points as well, which I actually don't I don't think have been covered by anybody else, but I really appreciate the poem, Paul. I'm just so glad that this is a church that allows speaking in tongues. But before I just begin, can I just say that we have unearthed an interview with Arthur, which we did in 1980s. David and Amy have been absolutely fascinated by this because they hadn't seen it before. I'd forgotten all about it. If you see me afterwards and give me your email address, I will send you the link so you can watch it. It really is worth watching, and you will hear a lot of things that people have talked about today. I think you will all agree with me that Arthur Bennison was a curious man. He had an insatiable curiosity about people and about things. When you went with him anywhere, and I'm sure Merv and Paul and John would agree with this, you got settled in, and Arthur went for what he called a paddle round. And he had a paddle round, and when he came back, he'd always met somebody who came from London but knew somebody in Stokesley and had somebody there and had a woman that, you know, used to work for him and all the rest of it. He always made connections between people. That's what he loved doing. That's what he did here at Hollybush all the time, and that's what he loved doing. But he also had an insatiable curiosity about how things worked. We nearly got run over in Prague trying to work out how the tram system worked, how the points worked. Because we decided it was going to turn left and it turned right, so we had to get out of the way pretty quick. That was what he was like. Everywhere he went, he had this insatiable curiosity. Also, he was a clever man. A lot of people didn't understand this because of the way he was, the way he spoke. He didn't like writing things down much. When you see the video later, you'll see a school report. And he was actually got graded A in maths, which we always knew he was very good at maths. And he was a clever man. When we were in Venice, we were sitting by the canal having our dinner, and Arthur's watching the gondoliers go past like they do. And he says, you know, those boats are shaped like a corkscrew. And when that man moves his foot from one side to the other, what he's actually doing is steering it. I would never have got that. Next day, we went down to the boatyard and we saw, actually, it's quite right, they are a corkscrew shape. And on the thing, it said, look, Arthur, you were quite right about that. These boats, it says here, they're asymmetrical. Asymmetrical? What's that mean? I said, it means that you were right. But you just don't have the language to get it. That's what he was like. He was a clever man. And I'll tell you something, there weren't many tradesmen that came here twice. Because Arthur watched them, and he could replicate what they did, and he was a very precise worker when he did it. Also, he was a countryman, as we've already heard. We would, the early days of doing the video, we took on an assignment in Blackpool. It's a huge convention centre, and we had wires going out for 70, 50, 80 yards. I don't know whether Phil Allison's in here today. He was helping us with that. Phil was great with that. Anyway, we were using coax aerial cable, and that was fine to transmit our signals to the control centre. Unfortunately, on the second day, we actually met somebody who knew what they were doing. He was actually worked in broadcast, and he looked at these cables, and with his nose turned up, you must have a terrible picture using those cables. So I said, well, I don't know, we don't know anything about it, actually. I didn't say that to him, obviously. And so I said, well, come and have a look, come up to our control room and see. So he came up the control room. Oh, yeah, yeah, they're pretty good pictures, aren't they, you know? He said, well, you know, we're kind of doing our best, you know. And then he looked around at all the equipment, and he says, but how did you learn all this? And Arthur's there, and he says, we're farmers. He said, what do you mean, you're farmers? He said, well, farmers can do anything. And that was Arthur's philosophy. He believed, as a countryman, that he was at the pinnacle of life. There was nothing, there was no higher calling than to be involved with animals and raising crops and working on the farm. He was a curious, clever countryman. And it's a great testimony to him that today, in our family, we have three generations represented who want to come and say what a privilege it is to know him. He has affected so many generations down through the years.
Hallelujah. What a privilege to be here. We're having fun at towards the burial. So this, my mind goes funny at times, and so I want to introduce something to you right now. And I've just written it down here. And shown Joanna it, because hey, Amy and your brother, who are going to say something shortly, you know, you're on a big thing here, because friends, this is going to be the new version of Every Day, the story of fun country folks. Anybody remember that? An everyday story of country folks. That used to be on quite a lot. And you can bring it up to date. Because it's copyright. Amen. Anyway, think of that if you want some cash. Glory to God. Very easily, I can only say, what a friend I have had in Arthur. And his wife, and as families we know them. And I'm lost in wonder, love, and thanksgiving. There's no more Arthurs. But there's a legacy there to follow for anybody who is willing to follow that legacy that Arthur took on, and Jane, all those years ago. And to conclude today in thanksgiving and rejoicing, because there's not many been like Arthur. There never will be many more people like Arthur. He was a Jesus man. A lot more people than Jesus men. I'm glad to say that I'm a Christian. I'm glad that I have been brought to this place with Cynthia down the years. When we got married, came down here. And Arthur has been part of our family before he got married to Jane. And it's just looking back. For both of them, what a wonderful partnership there has been. Oh yes, I'm saying this because one thing that Arthur didn't have much time for, sorry folks, is horses. blooming osses.
Sorry about that. That's the truth. Okay, bit of truth there. Take him away, take him away. Don't bring him near me. Anyway, that's Arthur, because he was real. He was just plain real. He was honest, plain honest. A privilege to know him, a privilege to have worked with him, a privilege to be a friend of his, and him a president of Jesus, and his wife.
Hallelujah.
And so today, I'm rejoicing. I don't mind yelling, because that's me inside. And Joanna as well, and Cynthia. Cynthia loved Arthur and Jane. The family grew up here, but they didn't last long till they got married. That's great. This is the family. Today we're going to be sharing just a bit of a few moments. But what more can I say? Not much, except he was a wonderful follower, and still is, of course, of Jesus. And I don't know how many, it says in God's word, in quite a few places, about people having crowns in glory. I assume that one king or queen only has one. Don't have another, after you've been a queen or a king, you don't get the same name again. You've got it for life. Arthur's got his testimony for life. Jane's got her testimony for life. All I do is I thank the Lord for Arthur. I could say a lot more. But this is his story. This is his story. This is Jane's story. And it's been a privilege to be part of their lives. God bless you.
Yes, a truly emotional time. He's sorely missed here on the farm. And we have two sheep, don't we, Amy, in the barn at the moment, that Jane, we brought, Jane wanted them here, Coco and Jelly Bean, Swarbles, and we're just waiting for them to lamb. And we thought today might be an appropriate day for that to happen. But yes, I was a bridesmaid for Jane and Arthur, and he lived with us in the house over there for many years. And we loved Arthur. Yeah. Arthur was always the same. Yeah. You know, regardless of whatever you threw at him, nothing seemed to faze Arthur. And he always kind of said, well, I'll pray for you, sis. It's all right. And I suppose he was the brother that I never had. And so we miss him. We'll miss him as all the family. But I just thought this was a fitting tribute, that many tributes have come in, and keep bringing them in, because we're doing a lovely book for the family. But I just thought this was really quite fitting. And we're all saying the same, I think. Arthur knew and loved Jesus. That was for sure. It was his Velcroed. That's for sure. It was as if he was Velcroed tightly to him, always ready to praise Jesus, make him known and encourage people. His love for Jesus was infectious. He was probably one of the most genuine people I have ever had the joy of meeting. And as we know, Arthur is unforgettable. His smile, joyful exuberance and sharp testimony of what he had been saved from were very real. A strong memory of Arthur since I knew him from 1970 onwards is the one of his love and devotion to Jim and Cynthia, honouring them and God's calling on their lives. His own call to be alongside them in practical ways, but also Arthur's servant heart towards them both and God's purposes. in prayer was wonderful to witness, being outworked over the years. When Arthur met and married Jane, it was also marvellous to see his gratitude to the Lord for Jane. A long-term memory is of Arthur co-driving with Jim, teams of young people, of which I was one, over to minister in fellowships in the Dales and also into Lancashire. He'd be singing choruses and encouraging us all as we journeyed on. I believe Arthur also went on daring missions with others in the 1970s, helping to smuggle Bibles behind the Iron Curtain. Not so long ago, summer 2018, maybe 2019, Arthur came into Hollybush office and had a chat one day when I was helping out with some office bits and pieces. His love for and loyalty to Jim and Cynthia and their calling still shone above and beyond whatever physical pain he himself was in. And he spoke of Jane and his children. And I remember thinking, what a privilege to have known a humble warrior of faith like Arthur. Now, Arthur has completed his journey here on earth, and as he entered into the joy of his Lord, he will have heard the Master say, "Well done, good and faithful servant."
Dad was truly a unique man, one of a kind, and we're blessed to know him as our father. To many of you, he will be known as Uncle Arthur. Dad was born on the 1st of March, 1942, or 1342, as he used to say to anyone who asked. He was born and bred in Broadfields Farm in Chopgate, Chopyat, to Leonard, a Methodist preacher and farmer, and Annie. He was the youngest of three children. His two older sisters were Hilda and late Audrey. Dad moved to Hollybush while still in his 20s and devoted over half a century to Hollybush Fellowship and the farm. He met and married our late mother Jane, and they lived in the farm cottage until her death in July 2022, when he moved to live with Amy.
Dad was very well travelled, particularly for a Dales man. While still in Billsdale, he would travel to Newcastle, Filey, London and Hollybush with his friends John, George and Paul, and probably others. Soon after he moved to Hollybush, he was travelling the length and breadth of the British Isles with Jim and Cynthia in the early days establishing Hollybush Christian Fellowship, sharing his testimony. He was an active member of the FGB, the Full Gospel Businessmen's Group. He visited America, Canada, Kenya, Thailand, supporting Mervyn and Lucy France, helping build a canteen for the children's home, as we've already heard. Australia, Nepal, and there's many other places I think we've heard today as well. Since retirement, Mum and Dad travelled to European cities with close family friends, Pete and Mary. They also holidayed with my family, providing extra pairs of hands and eyes at the airport and in the pool for our five young children. All these trips provided great memories and talking points. For example, when Dad ate tribes food in Kenya and ended up with a nasty stomach bug.
Dad was a very practical and resourceful, turning his hands to most things, and passed these skills on to me from an early age. Whether it's cutting logs, decorating, building walls, even a conservatory. He made Amy a doll's house for Christmas and pony jumps for his grandchildren. Electrical repairs were the only thing really that Dad would leave to the professionals. In the early days, he had a sideline business as well, selling rabbits to help pay for the fuel to travel down to Hollybush each week.
Material possessions were not important to him. He gracefully accepted when the family farm tenancy could not be passed down to him, firmly believing this was God's hand and then later God's calling to Hollybush. He would happily wear the same coat and wellies until they were beyond repair, and he would gather up many old broken items in the barn, probably a spring, Ernest, for your truck, in the garage just in case they were needed. He would always eat up those leftovers, even if they were well out of date. He didn't like to throw things away or waste food, and he would often refer to the children in Africa that he met when we weren't quite so keen to join him. Dad enjoyed his gardening. The only time I can remember him being unhappy was when I pulled up all of his winter heather from the rockery that he'd brought back from a holiday in Anglesey. I thought they were weeds. I also recall Mum saying she was mortified when David was born and Dad brought the wind-blown daffodils from the garden wrapped in newspaper for her to the hospital, leaving the lovely nice ones standing there in the garden.
In the early days at Hollybush, Dad had a great 70s comb-over hairstyle, heavily set in hairspray. During the parents' race at the sports day, it rose up like a shark's fin, providing amusement for all the children. Moving into the 80s, he had it cut off, much to Amy's devastation, as she enjoyed plaiting it. He was always a happy, cheery soul and would fill a room with joy. He loved to meet people. Greeting people on the door at Hollybush with his infectious smile and laugh. There is not many people I know who are comfortable entering a room full of strangers and getting to know people. Dad was one of them. At Centre Parks, he'd catch up with John, the pool attendant, each visit. He attended the church there, and he would tell us about all the people he'd met and who had heard about and visited Hollybush.
He put people at ease and had a wonderful ability to relate to people of all generations and backgrounds. From his outreach work in high security prisons through to children in playgroup. He always saw the good in everybody and everything. He would turn a negative into a positive and laugh off any mistakes. Even when he needed eye surgery after a sheep caught him, and then again in the other eye when he had an accident in the barn with a piece of wood, he would just accept his fate. The most he complained about was the watery blobs that he could see in his eyes. A very content, dependable person who would always remain calm. He was never angry. He would never shout. I don't remember him raising his voice, even with his 8 grandchildren climbing all over him. I found it surprising, actually, when he needed medication for high blood pressure.
Dad worked very hard on the farm. He would always finish on time for meetings on Tuesdays and Fridays, with Sundays always a day of rest. He was a Sunday school teacher, a leader for many years. We both enjoyed the sessions that he ran, as did our grandchildren many years later. He was a child at heart and would always make everything fun. We had a wonderful holiday in Devon when Mum was at summer school, going out for day trips, cream teas and swimming for hours. With the grandchildren, he would always enjoy playing the games, hyping them up, and knew just what spot to tickle to make them squirm and laugh.
Lambing time was a highlight for our family in the spring. Dad loved feeding the sheep and then clapping the empty bag on his side to spook the lambs to start what we called the Lamb National. Dad would laugh out loud every time.
Summer was a very busy time on the farm. Once hay time was complete, preparation for Hollybush camp commenced, pegging out the field, pulling the caravans into their positions. No daily chores were too much, such as the rubbish collection, the unblocking the drains, and even emptying the septic tank. He also ran the video team, capturing thousands of meetings over the years, taking orders and spending weeks after camp posting out copies.
Dad really enjoyed his final camp last summer. Mike Stanley very kindly picked him up every day, and despite his frailty at the time, he managed very well and he thoroughly enjoyed it. Hollybush Fellowship was as much his family as we were, particularly Jim, Cynthia and Joanna, and not forgetting Irene too. who welcomed him into their home and fellowship all those years ago. Dad enjoyed the harvest festivals at Sandhutton. The annual trip to North Allerton for bonfire night was also a fond memory of ours. Dad loved heat, spending a lot of time cutting logs, gathering sticks to keep the fire roaring. Dad also dressed up as Father Christmas, visiting playgroups and primary schools. On one occasion, he actually travelled by helicopter. Dad loved his singing. Every Christmas, we would go carol singing around the villages and on Christmas morning at the Fryeridge Hospital.
Dad learnt to swim late in life. He wanted to make the most of the flumes and rides at Centre Parks, particularly when the grandchildren came on the scene. Although the first time down a flume at Penrith was almost his last, when he lost his footing and ended up upside down in the fast current. Fortunately, Jimmy saw him and floundering and fished him out. Dad led a simple life, focused predominantly around Hollybush and his unquestionable faith. He also enjoyed watching cricket and snooker, playing Scrabble with Irish Michael, and doing jigsaw puzzles. In later life, Dad played bowls at Topcliffe. He enjoyed meeting all the people. Winning was great, but taking part, chatting, and having a laugh was the main motivation.
Dad developed vascular dementia, diagnosed at a late stage due to COVID. Having said that, he could recall times tables rapidly, better than me. No wonder he got that A in maths in his end of school report, which you'll see later. He remained happy, content, and at peace to the very end. A reflection, I suppose, of his whole life that he led. We're very grateful for all the care that he received. Vicky supporting Dad whilst at Hollybush, and then the first care services when he moved to our house. Heather, Charlotte, Alicia and George were some of his favourites. Everyone enjoyed caring for him, and he thoroughly enjoyed their company.
We know his kind heart and love touched so many people's lives. He could never be replaced, but a little bit of him is on in us, our children, and we're very grateful for that.
Thanks, Dad.
I had one leg longer than the other, we were walking on the other side, you see. When I dropped off in 67, I'd been down to the pub and to dance afterwards in the village of Harlow. Well, it was a good town. And landed home in the dark rocking chair back home. And, well, I wonder what had gone wrong, really. And God was saying, I want to come in, and the devil was saying, it's all right, put it off. Well, eventually it came to a position where I had to say yes. And from then on, well, drinking, gambling, all the lot just went out the door, just
going to sing a few songs now, but we're going to do it with your help, because it wouldn't be Hollybush just to listen to us, would it? So we're going to celebrate the truth that we know today is that Arthur's with his Heavenly Father. He's in heaven. We're going to sing some songs about the great promise that we have as Christians, that this is not the end. And for Arthur, eternity has already begun.
There's a love that is fairer than dew.
Leads me to the promise. Keep getting wheeled out for these events. And, you know, it's with sadness and joy that you can come and honour to speak of somebody like Arthur. I'm not here to actually pray. It sounds like a quote from Shakespeare. I'm not here to praise Arthur this afternoon. I'm here to remind us of the wonderful truth that we believe as Christians. Death is not the end. Hallelujah. At Easter, we remember Jesus' resurrection. It's a turning point in the lives of those people who had been following him faithfully for many years, who had witnessed the horror of a crucifixion, and were now anxious, desperate, fearful men and women hiding behind closed doors, locked doors, wondering what was going to happen next. And suddenly, among them stood the risen Lord, proving through his resurrection that there is life after death, that death has been conquered, that death is not, it might be the final enemy, but it is not the end of everything. This difference changed a group of people who really thought we'd go back fishing, we'd given up, it's all over, to bravely run the race, to bravely face persecution and trials, and go around the world and share a hope that they had witnessed for themselves, that Jesus was no longer dead, but he was alive, the living Lord and Savior. Jesus had said to his followers, "Don't be anxious or worried or troubled. Trust in God. And trust in me as well. In my heavenly Father's home, there are many rooms or many dwelling places." And Jesus said to his followers, "I am going to prepare a place for you. And I will take you there to be with me." See, for Christians, eternity or our heaven is not just some vague hope that we have. It's not some sort of fantasy that we believe in. We don't believe, as many people that you hear at funerals talk about, well, he was a good person, or that was a good person, therefore, you know, fingers crossed, we think they've made it. We don't rely on our innate goodness as human beings. We don't try to convince ourselves or one another that, you know, this was such a good bloke that he really deserved to be in heaven. For us as Christians, this blessed hope, this security, this promise of eternal life, which is certain and secure for us, it's part of our core belief in the Christian faith, is the promise of Jesus to each one of us. And it's a promise based on the work of Jesus, who made it possible for us in his death and glorious resurrection. Arthur is today enjoying a dwelling place that Jesus prepared for him. And I can visualize him just, you know. You know, his hands on his knees, big smile on his face, but he's home. His home. For family and friends, obviously, we're going to miss Arthur. His laughter, really infectious. His hugs, really huge. I mean, the first time I ever came to this place was in June 1970 as an 11-year-old. And the first person I ever met at Hollybush on the night I became a Christian was Arthur Bennison. And what he did was he grabbed hold of me. I was an 11-year-old lad. You know, I wasn't used to strange men grabbing hold of me. He looked up my left nostril like he used to do, you know, rubbed my back, as he often did, and said, "Now then, bro." I thought, well, who's this? Thankfully, Arthur didn't put me off becoming a Christian that night. And, you know, he was just infectious, that we've heard that word before, his joy, his love of life, his encouragement. Bye, lad, his stories. And we've all got those memories that are not going to fade and that keep him alive in our hearts and in our memories. We know it's not the same as having him with us. But as we've heard, Arthur's left an imprint on so many people. Look, I've got no idea what they're going to make of him in heaven. I really don't. Even if they can understand him. But, you know, but I know he's there. And he will be walking around, chatting to people, you know, because he could move around a room like this. And he was no respecter of persons. It didn't matter if you were a well-known speaker or you were somebody who just turned up for the first time. He was the same with people. Fantastic. I just see him in heaven, having the time of his life. You know, Peter, I am Peter. Remember them stories? It was great, you know, lad. And Peter thinking, can somebody interpret, you know? Arthur, we believe as Christians, this joyful, glorious good company that he was, sometimes because of his stubbornness and because of, you know, my grumpiness, he could be annoyingly joyful. I don't know if you ever thought that. Why couldn't he be just normal like the rest of us, you know? Arthur is more alive today than he ever was on earth. He's alive forevermore. Wow. Because of the promise of Jesus Christ. Because of what Jesus has done in his life. And we've heard the readings from Scripture, that reading from Revelation that Mervyn brought us. Arthur's not sat in a white nightie with a pair of wings and a halo playing a harp. He's enjoying a quality of life that we know nothing about on this earth. It's a real place. The writer of the book of Revelation said, this is trustworthy and true stuff. Write it down. Let people know. They need to know the truth of this. New heaven, new earth, the dwelling of God with us forever. Arthur is enjoying this. He's living with God as a child of God, the son of God. That scripture says, for him, there is no more sorrow. There's no more pain. There's no more crying. And there's no more death. Come on. Scripture also tells us there's no mourning for Arthur. There is for us. We miss him. But he's promised a glorious time. A glorious inheritance. Now, Arthur loved life. We've heard that. He loved his family. He loved his friends. He loved Hollybush. But he also truly loved God. And now he's home. He's in his eternal home. A home that the Lord has prepared for him. I wonder what's on the walls. I wonder what God has prepared for Arthur. Maybe something, some mechanical thing for him to make or to mend. I don't know. But there'll be something for Arthur that is just special to him. So we say goodbye perhaps rightly with tears for a lot of us, because he can never be replaced on earth. I don't know anyone like Arthur. I've never met anyone like him in my life. But we say goodbye with a confidence in God's grace and God's goodness and God's promise that the end is not yet, praise the Lord, and the half has never yet been told. God bless you, Arthur. You were loved here. You're going to be loved in heaven. We honour you. Amen.
Thank you, Jonathan, for those wonderful words of encouragement and assurance that our hope and our living is not in vain in the Lord. It's my privilege now to lead us in a short prayer of thanks for Arthur's life. And at the end of the prayer, I invite you to join in the Lord's Prayer with me, which I think will come on the screen for anyone who needs a prompt. But maybe we just begin with a moment of quiet, just allow you to reflect for a moment, one more time, on our dear brother Arthur Bennison. So let us pray. Loving Lord, we come before you now to give you our heartfelt thanks for the gift of Arthur Bennison into all of our lives. We do thank you for Arthur, all that he did, all that he experienced, and all of the things for which he's now lovingly remembered. We thank you for that unique character that we've heard so much about, his love of life that we've heard so much about, his love of people, his readiness to help. So many, many memories of a life well lived. We say thank you, Lord, for that indelible impression that he's left on all of our lives. But we realize he will be missed, and so we pray especially now for Amy and Jimmy, David and Catherine, Alice, Holly, Maisie, Harriet, Millie, Harry, Hannah, Isabel. And we remember Arthur's sister, Hilda, one more time. Lord, comfort this family in the way that only you can, and console them with all of the treasured memories that they hold dear. And indeed, for every one of us here who mourns the loss of Arthur, thank you for the strength of your presence, for the comfort of the knowledge that it is well with Arthur's soul. We pray that it may be well with the soul of all of us in this room today. Father, that even now someone might know, might feel that need to just surrender their lives to you in following Arthur's example, and claiming you as our Lord, not just Arthur's Lord, or Arthur's shepherd, but our Lord, my shepherd. So we give you all the praise, Lord. We give you all the glory today through Christ our Lord. Amen. So we say together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. So would you stand with me as we sing our closing hymn, How Great Thou Art, O Lord My God. Let's stand together. And once again, raise the roof.
Oh,
remain standing with me, please, for the commendation. So we come now to this moment when we commend Arthur into God's loving care, not as though he's not already there, of course. But we come now to honor our dear brother. We thank God for the gift of Arthur's life to us. As a dear and loving husband to the late Jane, father to Amy and David, granddad to his grandchildren, and a special brother in Christ and friend to each one of us here. Our lives have been enriched, have they not, by the presence of this dear man. And now, that which God gave to us, we give back to him. So now, dear Lord, we commend Arthur into your loving care. We're sad that he's no longer enriching our lives, but we're glad that we know he's with you, hearing those precious words, "Well done, faithful servant." And so, dear Arthur, as we've honored your life and reflected on your memory, we commend you now into the care of our Heavenly Father. Lord, by your mighty power, you conquered death, and in your love, you have given us the promise of eternal life through Christ Jesus. And so, placing our faith in you and in your promises, we now entrust Arthur into your care and keeping through Christ our Lord. Arthur, go from this world in the name of God the Father who created you, in the name of Christ the Son who redeemed you, and in the name of the Holy Spirit who breathed his eternal life into your soul. Amen. Amen. I'm going to close this moment with a scripture, which, if you'll allow me, I'd like to paraphrase. And then we're going to do something that you've maybe never done before at a funeral. But I think we're all here today sensing the thankfulness to God for a life well lived. And so as Arthur makes his final journey from Hollybush, I invite you, not now, but when that moment comes and the music plays, let's applaud a life well lived, an example well left. And just one, I know there's been many thoughts, but if an unassuming man from Billsdale can create such an impact on literally thousands of lives, let's take something from this funeral service today. Make your life living worthwhile and memorable, not in the way of humanity, but in glory to God and in memory of our Lord and Savior. So I close with this scripture as the gentlemen make their way forward. From 2 Timothy 4, but paraphrase. Arthur has fought the good fight. He has finished the race. He has kept the faith. Finally, he has received the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to him on that day. Not to him only, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen.